Macmillan Audio presents Turning Darkness into Light by Marie Brennan. Read for you by Barrie Kreinik and Raphael Corkhill.
Stupendous find in Archaea. Newly discovered cache of Draconian inscriptions, Lord Glanley's triumph. True history will be revealed at last. Though nearly barren of water, the deserts of Archaea are a wellspring of secrets. Year by year, their sands disclose the remains of the ancient Draconian civilization, which has fascinated the public for hundreds, nay, thousands of years. Today, they have given into the hands of mankind a priceless treasure, nearly the equal of the Watcher's Heart itself, a tremendous cache of inscriptions, hidden by unknown hands in the deepest recesses of a cave, lost to memory, until now. An expedition led by Marcus FitzArthur, the Earl of Glanley, ventured into the barren region known as the Carja, where archaeologists had little hope of significant discovery. While sheltering from the midday heat, the Earl himself found the cache, containing hundreds of tablets never before seen by modern scholars. What hands buried them in the sheltering earth of that cave, so far from any settlement yet discovered? Was this the act of some ancient hermit, or miser protecting his library against the eyes of others? Was it an attempt to safeguard these texts against the violence of the downfall that ended Draconian rule? We may never know unless the words themselves give some hint to their value or origin. But the content of the tablets is as yet unknown. Lord Glanley insisted on their prompt removal before looters could flock to the site and steal away this priceless treasure. He is already making plans to bring them to his estate at Stokesley, where he has amassed one of the most extensive private collections of Draconian antiquities in the world. When approached for comment, Simeon Caval of the Tomfries Museum offered the following statement. "We congratulate Lord Glanley on his stroke of good fortune and hope that the world shall not find him behindhand in sharing the details of this cache with the public." From the Office of the Curator of Draconian Antiquities to Alan Preston. 14th of Nivis, Tomfries Museum, 12 Chisholm Street, Folchester. "Dear Alan, all right, you win. Lord Glanley is every bit as insufferable as you warned me. I drove through the dark just to stay at an inn rather than accept that man's hospitality for the night. His private collections are every bit as stupendous as rumor claims, but it's hard for me to admire anything when I know he must have acquired half of it in shady overseas markets, and the other half from our own shady markets here in Skirland. He is exactly the kind of customer Joseph Dorak and his ilk like to cultivate. He clearly cares nothing for the artifacts in their own right, only for the prestige they bring him, especially the Draconian materials. When I think of the bas-reliefs alone, treasures chiseled off their original homes to decorate the walls of that hulk he calls an ancestral estate, and probably smuggled onto our shores, I tell you, I could weep. The Archaean government would never have given him permission to search the Carja if they'd had the slightest clue he would find anything of value there. Now he is in possession of what the papers insist on calling the greatest archaeological find since the Watcher's Heart. I'll lay odds he bought that coverage himself, and there is nothing anyone can do about it. I cannot decide whether it would be better or worse if he had any facility at all for languages. Such knowledge would give him a greater appreciation for what he has found. On the other hand, he would probably undertake to study the inscriptions himself and undoubtedly make a botch of it, for he has not the dedication to do it well. As it stands, Lord Glanley is so jealous of his find that I had to argue with him for hours before he would even let me see the whole of it, rather than a few scattered tablets. Never mind that I cannot possibly be expected to deliver a well-informed judgment on the material if I have no information to judge from. But I finally convinced him, and so here is the long and short of it. The cache consists of 271 tablets or fragments thereof. Some of those fragments likely belong together. There are at least three pairs I'm certain of, but a great many more that would require further examination. If I had to guess, the final count would be closer to 230. Their condition is highly variable, though it's unclear how much of that is due to botched conservation. Credit where it is due, Glanley did have the sense to attend to that right away, so we hopefully shouldn't see any more salt damage. But some of the tablets are fairly weathered, from their burial, I imagine, and a few have suffered extensive surface crumbling, which I fear will make decipherment of those sections difficult, if not impossible. In terms of subject matter, they're an assortment, and I didn't have enough time to do more than a quick assessment. Some queen lists, a few carved into limestone that look to be royal decrees, quite a lot that appear to be completely prosaic tax records. I sometimes think the literary production of Draconian civilization was 50% tax records, if not more. But as for the rest, yes, the rumors are true, or at least I think they are. 14 of the tablets are shaped to a uniform size and thickness, with what looks like the hand of the same scribe at work on them. They seem to form a continuous text, judging by the notably archaic nature of the language. It's riddled with obsolete signs, which made assessing anything quite a challenge. What little I was able to pass at a glance seems to be a narrative. Whether Lord Glanley is right to call it the lost history of Draconian civilization, I cannot say without further examination, but it is unquestionably a breathtaking find. And completely wasted on such a man. However, there is hope. Given how reluctant Glanley was to let me see the tablets, I thought I would have to spend months persuading him to have them translated and published. But apparently he recognizes that no one will care about what he has found 5 years from now, unless they know what it says, because he suggested translation before I could even bring it up. What's more, I have persuaded him that the dignity of his ancient name requires the greatest care and attention be given to these tablets. Your mind has already leapt in a certain direction, I'm sure, but I shall surprise you by steering you two generations down. I think we should recruit Audrey Camherst. In my opinion, she is easily her grandfather's equal, where knowledge of the Draconian language is concerned. Furthermore, she has the advantage of her sex. You yourself said that Lord Glanley treats every man who comes near him as either an inferior or a threat to his own prestige, neither of which would serve us well in this instance. Miss Camherst, being a woman, will not provoke him to such displays of superiority. And if he does try to throw his weight around, well, Audrey has her grandmother's name to use as a weapon and shield alike. Given that her family's attentions are currently focused on preparing for the Fallchester Congress next winter, I doubt her grandfather could spare the time and care this task would require, but Audrey would leap at the chance. I have not yet recommended her to Lord Glanley's attention, as I think the lady deserves some amount of warning before I drop him on her doorstep. But unless you have a strong argument to the contrary, I intend to write to her as soon as possible. The world is panting to see what those tablets have to say, and we should not make them wait. Your friend, Simeon.
From the Diary of Audrey Camherst. 4th of Pluvis. Arrived at Lord Glanley's estate today in a torrential downpour that transformed me into a drowned rat in the brief interval between motor car and door. Wouldn't have happened if his footman had the common sense to keep an umbrella in the car. Bad service or calculation on Lord Glanley's part? I know Simeon doesn't think the Earl will feel the need to posture at me since I'm not a man, but I am unconvinced. My impression, based on an admittedly short acquaintance thus far, is that he's utterly delighted that the granddaughter of Lady Trent herself has come all this way to look at his tablets. But from what Simeon said, Alan said, I can't help but wonder if he fears the stories will start being all about me instead of him. Letting me get soaked might be his way of putting me in my place. If being put in my place is the entry fee for seeing the tablets, I will pay it. From what I hear of him, Lord Glanley's usual habit is to huddle over his find like a mother dragon brooding over her eggs. Why is it that we still use that simile, even though Grandmama has made it clear that most of them don't brood? It is nothing short of a miracle that he is eager to see his new find published, and I can't quite trust that he won't change his mind. If he does, well, I am not above smuggling out copies of my papers, and the consequences be damned. Father will bail me out, I'm sure. Then I can look all tragic and determined for the press, who will eat it up with a spoon. Lord Glanley was taken aback when he saw me, and I don't think it was because of my soaking. People have a tendency to forget who my mother is, even though anything our family does becomes headline news. They expect me to look skeerling, and are always surprised when I don't. But he recovered quickly, I will give him that much. Miss Camherst, he said, offering the appropriate courtesies. Welcome to Stokesley. I am sorry your journey was so fatiguing. It's like the monsoon out there, I said, dripping steadily onto his marble floor. But that's all right. I would have swum all the way here if that's what it took. When can I get started? That took him aback again. My dear girl, you only just got here. I would not dream of putting you to work so soon. It always sticks in my craw when someone calls me girl. I am 23 and a grown woman. But I'm likely to be a girl in everyone's eyes until I'm grey or married. You're not putting me to work, I said. I'm putting myself. Really, I can't wait to see the tablets. Just let me towel myself dry. Of course, I was wasting my breath. First, I had to be shown to my room. Then Lord Glanley's maid tried to insist on drawing a bath, saying I must be chilled to the bone. Which I was, a little, but I didn't care. I did dry myself off, and then happened to glance in a mirror and discovered my hair was going every which way, as it does when the weather is damp. The maid wanted to fix that for me, but it was obvious she didn't have the first notion how to subdue my mane. I pinned it up myself, put on dry clothes, and sallied out again in search of my host and my purpose for being there. Only, of course, he had to take me on a tour of the family pile, entirely so he could show off his collection. The man has no taste, nor any sense of order whatsoever. He has crammed Nikaian friezes around Koyawak frescoes with a monstrous great Yelangese vase in front of them so you can hardly see what's behind. And the Draconian antiquities. I don't think he knows or cares that he has hatching murals looming over mortuary stelae in a way that would have appalled the ancients. But Simeon warned me, so I oohed and aahed as expected, and only made faces when his back was turned. Eventually, we got down to business. Lord Glanley said, I should tell you, Miss Camherst, that I have some requirements for this undertaking. If they are agreeable to you, then you may begin work tomorrow. No wonder he hadn't shown me the tablets yet. Mind you, he could have had the decency to inform me about these requirements before I came all the way out here. But Lord Glanley isn't a complete fool. He knew it would be that much harder for me to refuse when I was in the same building as the tablets, separated from them only by a few thin walls. I should be glad to hear your requirements, I told him, as politely as I could. They are not onerous, he promised me,
The first is that I will need you to work here rather than removing the tablets elsewhere. I shall, of course, provide room and board as part of your compensation for as long as you require, and make arrangements for your belongings to be brought here. Live at Stokesley? I shouldn't be surprised. It's entirely reasonable for studying material.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.